Welcome friends to EPG Patashala. I am Dr. N. Janardana, working as faculty in the Department of Psychiatric Social Work, NIMHANS, Bengaluru. Today let us understand what is counselling, a basic introduction to counselling, and how what is counselling and what is not counselling need to be understood, because this term, the word counselling, been misutilized and been used inappropriately in many circumstances. So I have seen people using word, I counsel person to take medicine, I counsel person to use aids and appliances. Is it counselling or information sharing is something we need to be questioned. So let us understand what is counselling and how it is different from giving advice. Okay, let us now look at the meaning and definition towards the counselling. There are many definitions people have given with regard to counselling. Something common in all this definition is that a counselling is a process organized in a series of steps which aims to help people cope better with the situation they are facing. It involves helping the individual to understand their emotions and feeling and to help them to make a positive choices and decision. It is always allow clients to make choices and decision rather than you making a decision for the client. Let us look at the characteristics of counselling. Counselling is not the same thing as giving advice. Then what is counselling? We need to reflect upon this. Many a times we use the word counselling to give advice. In NGOs, whenever I call for a training program for a counsellor, it will be always the project head would come for the counselling training. But practically, as a project head, he may not be able to take up the role of counselling. But in organization, counsellor is viewed as a person who can give suggestions to all problems. So they view counsellor as a person who carry with a big bag of advices so that he can give advices to any problem whoever approached to him. So counselling emphasizes thinking with, not for the individual. So this need to be understood clearly. Always we, as an advisor during counselling, we would think for the client and give advices. But actually counselling is a process through emphasizing thinking with the client and make the client to think and allow him to make a decision and exercise his choice, whatever he or she want to do. Counselling helps the client to make their own decision. You are, as a counsellor, guide them to a solution by helping them to see different options and making them their own choices. Your job is to help them to see various solutions which are available for that problem and allow the client to make a decision, even though the decision seems to be wrong according to your judgment, but you are not supposed to enforce your thinking. It is always make the person to think for himself. Counselling is centered on difficulties of the client. Counselling is a learning situation which eventually results in a behavioral change. So always through the process of counselling, it should lead to behavioral change. Client should be able to make a change for himself, and the people around him also should be able to appreciate those changes. Effectiveness in counselling depends largely on readiness of the client to make changes and therapeutic relationship with the counsellor. The counsellor relationship should be kept confidential. It's not good to discuss about the client's issues in a public forum. Even if you are discussing in a public forum, always the identity of the person needs to be kept in mind. And always it should be with the peer group, it should be disclosed so that we can get the peer supervision or peer suggestions can be obtained while providing counselling services. So counselling is a client-centered base. Each individual client needs, issues and circumstances are different. So always the interventions need to be tailor-made intervention. So we cannot go with a package and say that I am going to provide this intervention to these clients. So based upon the client's problem, the intervention also need to be designed and services need to be provided. Counselling should be a process of empowering the client to help himself. This is a basic principle of social work, is to help people to help themselves. The counselling also should be ending up with empowering the client so that the client would make a decision for himself, and client would also build a skill of problem solving skills in him, so that in future, whenever the client is facing a problem, he would use the problem solving skills in order to resolve the problem for himself. Counselling is an interactive, collaborative and respectful process where the client would be client would experience the respectfulness, and it's a collaborative effort and always an interactive where lot of chances need to be provided for the client to interact with the counselor, so that the counselor, the client would experience the respectfulness and collaborate with the counselor in order to make decision for changing himself. Counseling is based on client socio-cultural context and readiness to change. It's a process of asking questions, eliciting information, reviewing points and developing action plans. During the process of counseling, counselor cannot go with a set of questions prepared like one after the other. This question would be asked. Client to counselor should have a good observation skill and also good listening skill. Based on the response the client gives, the counselor should be able to put back a question so that the further elaboration with regard to the problem can be explored, and then help the client to understand the situation where he is in. Usually in a counseling process, when a counselor is asking a question, the person who is answering will be the first person to listen. It's not the counselor who is sitting across the table. The process of asking question itself would help the client to get insight about his problem, and 50% of the problem would get resolved during the assessment process itself, because the counselor is the counselor is making the client to express the feeling and associated with the problem. That itself would act as a solution for the problems. So let us understand what is not counseling. Giving advice is not counseling. Taking decision for your client is not counseling. Telling or directing the clients is not counseling. A conversation or a mere discussion cannot be called as counseling. An interrogation is not called as counseling. A confession is not counseling. Praying is not counseling. But the word counseling has been misutilized and been abused a lot. People often tend to take up the role of giving advice or taking decision, directing, conversation or interrogation as part of counseling. Whenever we practice counseling in various settings, particularly in while working with children in difficult circumstances or children who are in children home, as a counselor, he is expected to interrogate the child and get the information about whereabouts of his parents' address and what happened. Particularly in case where a child had a romantic relationship with an adult and decided to run away from home and get married. So as a counselor, he's expected to interrogate and find out when did they run away from home, what made them to run away from home, and what went on, did they get married, not get married, whether they had a sexual intercourse. So all those information need to be elicited. So they expect the counselor to be an interrogation. But that process is itself is not a counseling. It's more of an interrogation which can be used at the police setting, where it's mere collection of facts in order to establish an act. So all these things are not counseling, but people consider this as counseling. And often I hear people saying that counsel the child to stop crying. So I don't know how we can counsel the child to stop crying. So the word has been loosely used and inappropriately been used. So now let us understand the difference between what is counseling and information sharing. Counseling is usually confidential, whereas information sharing is not a confidential thing, because the information it's need to be shared with everyone, so there is no point maintaining confidentiality in information sharing. Whereas in counseling, confidentiality need to be maintained. Counseling is usually a one-to-one process, or in a small group it can be done, whereas information sharing can be done in a small or a larger group of people, where the objective of is to share the information so that the awareness has been generated in the people. Counseling evokes a strong emotion in both counselor and the client, whereas in information sharing, the emotionality remains neutral because it's only one-sided, where the information has been shared to a group of people and chances of interactions are less. Whereas in counseling, always there has been a chance of interaction between the counselor and the client is going to be more, because counselor is going to ask questions and client would be responding. Based on the response, client again going to make a question. So there will be a lot of emotion sharing which happens between the counselor and the client. And similar atmosphere we don't see in information sharing. Counselling is more focused, specific and goal targeted, whereas information sharing is generalized. So usually like in a public forum, the information is come and shared, which will be generalized for everyone. Whereas in counselling, it is more focused and goal oriented, and each session would be planned and goal for each session would have been established, and based on the session would be carried forward. Information used to change attitudes and motivate behavioral change, whereas in information used to increase knowledge and education. That is the difference between counselling and information, where information is used for building knowledge, whereas in counselling information can be used in terms of motivating the behavioral change. And in counselling, it's issue oriented, whereas information is content oriented. Counselling and advice. So let us now understand the difference between what is counselling and what is advice. Counselling enables the client to identify his own strengths and capabilities and help him to use the same to resolve the issues. Through the process of counselling, the client will be empowered in understanding his own strengths so that he can use those strengths and resolve the problem. Whereas in advice, it is always the client asks for what to do, and advice is given with the expectation that what is told will be done. Let us take a situation where a family would come to a psychiatric social worker asking that my son need to get married, and we have already selected a girl for her, and this girl almost marriage is fixed and he got engaged and next month is the marriage. If we take up a role of giving advice, so we would end up saying that it's not good to get him married at this stage because he is still under treatment. Marriage itself can cause as a stressor for him. If he is unable to deal with the stress, it can lead to relapse. So we would take that as an advisor role. If we act as a counselor, so instead of giving advice, we would engage the family into a discussion, find out the reason why they want to get their son married, and most of the time it would have been like shifting the responsibility, and then get into the discussion, okay, not disclosing about illness to the spouse, what would be the difficulties they would encounter. The first difficulty would be taking medicine, hiding from the spouse, so which may happen in for few days or few months, later it would be known to the spouse, and what would be the reaction of the spouse. In case if the spouse decide to go for a separation or a divorce, so what would be the state of their son. So if we can get into those discussion, families also would be able to make a decision, and either they want to go like continue this marriage or want to break up this marriage. Let the family make a decision rather than just if giving an advice. Always people may follow or may not follow, and if they don't follow, as a person who gave an advice, we also would feel that day I told you but you people did not follow, now you are into the problem. So we will be taking up that role as a counselor. If we allow the client to make a decision, whatever good or bad decision, the client will take the responsibility. Here the client would be, family would take the responsibility for good and also the bad. So in counselling, it's a holistic understanding of client is very important, whereas when giving advice, it's not always necessary to have a understanding of the client or the client's problem. So decision making is wholly the responsibility of the client and counselee. The advisor is making decision for the individual. And always it's like an external party making a decision, whereas in counselling it's an internal person who is part of the problem who would make a decision for himself. Counselling is a process, whereas advice giving may be an incident and will be over in a brief meeting. Counselling promotes individual abilities and independence, whereas advice promotes dependency, which is not good for any person. Let us now understand what should be the aim of counselling. The aim of counselling should be to assist client in exploring their problem and guide them towards solution. To have clients become aware of the consequences of the experiences and situation they have been or going through. Aim is to reduce worry, anxiety or any other negative emotion. Aim is to guide clients in their recovery from an adaptation to a difficult circumstances. So we need to establish what should be the aim of the counselling, and based on the aim of the counselling, we need to initiate our conversation with the client. Now let us look at the qualities of a good counsellor. Who is a good counsellor? Good counsellor is a person who accepts the client as he or she is, and express positive regard, respond to the client as worthy human being more concretely, selecting positive aspects of the client's story, selectively attending to positive aspects of client's statement. Counselor should give respect and warmth, showing through non-verbal behavior such as open posture, smile, vocal qualities. The comments need to be congruent with the body languages. Good counselor is a person who follow the principle of non-judgmental attitude. It means spending one's own opinion and attitudes and assumes a value neutrality in relation to the client. It can be expressed through vocal qualities and body languages and by statements that indicate neither approval nor disapproval. I would like to give an example of non-judgmental attitude here. Some time back I was working as a counselor in an HIV/AIDS setting, where an husband who was diagnosed as having HIV came to me for post-test counseling, and during the process of post-test counseling, husband seems depressed and also expressed that he would like to continue unsafe sexual practices with the wife and do not want to disclose his status to the wife. And then at one point of time, as a counselor, I was a bit angry with the situation where husband is not taking responsibility towards the wife. Somewhere I became judgmental, and then I have to just alter myself. I said I am going to talk to him next session, and I took time to work on my judgmental thing. Right now he is a client, I should not be judging him and pass on my negative attitude in the process of counselling. So it's better whenever we get into such situation where we feel that we are judging a situation, it's better to take a break and then come back later. Later we can talk to the client and talk to him, discuss about the need for disclosing it to wife in case if she is still not positive, how that would help the family situation. And sometimes wife, it's a right of the wife to know about the husband's health status. And also, she also has a right in terms of protecting herself from HIV. And if husband can show that concern, in turn wife also can be concerned towards him. So next session we engaged with the client with all this discussion. And then again allowed the client to make a decision about what he want to do, whether he want to disclose with his wife or not. Authenticity and congruence is another quality a counselor should have, where a counselor need to be congruent and genuine, not display many discrepancies. Confidentiality, they need to be maintained, healthy boundaries. They know how to say no, which allows them to keep a balance in their lives. Now let us look at the process of counseling. There are three processes of counseling. First one is initial stage, where the client self-exploration would happen. So client should be encouraged to self-exploration and their concerns need to be clarified. General counseling goals are set and the working alliance has to be established in that initial stage. So gathering information and observing the client, the counselor arrives at some tentative hypothesis regarding the nature and the complexity of the problem. Based on the hypothesis, the intervention is also being planned. Sometimes this hypothesis may be wrong, so always there should be a chance for revisiting the hypothesis so that the better understanding of the client situation would arrive and the solution can be looked at. Middle phase, that is a deeper exploration and analysis. The shift of counselor attention from client's external problem to his internal problem would happen. where a cognitive level to emotional level into discussions would happen, whereas in the initial phase it would have been more of a cognitive level of interaction. In the middle phase, there will be an emotional level involvement in the discussion, so that the client would be able to understand the situation, what he has been undergoing, and that would help him to make a decision for himself. More intensively with the client, confront them with contradictions whenever they have been giving contradictory information. So the confrontation can happen, and it will also help the client to come to some conclusion rather than having his contradictions. Transference, counter-transference, resistance are the other issues which comes under the middle phase, where the client started being depending on the counselor, and for anything and everything he would look forward for a counselor. Counter-transference, where the counter-transference would be from the counselor's side, where he would get bulked up with the client's problem and started showing excessive empathy and excessive involvement, which is not a good sign of a counselor. So in final stage, implementation of goals through action, that is considered as a final stage of the counseling, where we should act upon the reality based upon the problem the client has been facing, and it should lead towards more self-awareness, help the client to be assertive, genuine, and start generalizing this to everyday life, develop constructive action along with the client. And emphasis is on making change in behavior, attitude, and skill specified as goals in the initial stage. So once the behavior, attitudes, and skills are changed, the client will have a better control over his life situation. There are some specific strategies as a counselor can follow during the counseling session, like role-playing behavior is a very important technique, which is a strategy which needs to be used during a counseling session, particularly when we are working with the couple for marital counseling, where the faulty communications would have been identified, and those faulty communications can be put as a role play back, where the communication, how that can be communicated in a different way, can be explored with the clients. When the husband communicate, and what would be the reaction of a wife, if the same communication has been communicated in a different way, then how the reactions would change. So that can be role played, and so that couple will understand it's through the communication people have been misunderstood, and the intentions would be different, whereas communication would be different. So those role plays can be played. For example, when we are doing a parenting intervention, we need to give a situation to the couple and help them to take a role play in terms of disciplining the child, what should be the father's response and what should be the mother's response whenever the child has been throwing a temper tantrum, and how the responses can be modified so that the inconsistency can be reduced. So which can be tried through a role play and rehearsals. A lot of rehearsals also can be as part of a strategy of counseling, where the example what I had given earlier, where husband decided not to disclose his HIV status to wife, in case if the same husband has taken a decision, I would disclose my HIV status to wife, then we can have a rehearsal in terms of how we would talk to his wife, and in what way he can convince his wife and communicate the illness condition what he or she has been facing. So that we can have a lot of rehearsal as a strategies which can be used in counseling. And rehearsals can also be like for a person with mental illness who want to get into an employment. Again, a rehearsal should be given in terms of how he would introduce himself and how he would face the interview, so that it will help him to gain confidence, and once the person gains confidence, he'll be able to go and perform well in the interview. Assertive training is another important strategy which can be used in counseling, where clients have been taught to use assertiveness whenever they are in a situation where peer pressure would either force them to go back to the decision of abstaining themselves from the alcohol or abstaining themselves from the nicotine. So they should be able to use that assertiveness and say, no, it's not possible, like I have taken a decision, I don't want to go back with the decision. Assertiveness training also plays an important role while we are working with the couple who are undergoing domestic violence in the family. And violence of any sort is not acceptable. So we should be able to train the wife who always been subject to violence to be assertive enough and stop the husband whenever he wanted to use his power against her and whenever he wanted to be using violence against the wife. So all these three strategies need to be part of counseling. Termination. So usually when do we terminate the session? When the goals set have been met and we maximize counseling outcome as well as maintain new learning in the later life situation. Always the doors will be kept open even after termination. Client can always come back whenever he or she faces a new set of problem. But counseling should be able to empower them so that they will be able to deal with the problem. Whenever they are stuck with not able to confront the situation, they can always come back to a counselor and discuss with the counselor and empower themselves with the skills so that they will be able to face the situation. Now let me summarize the last 30 minutes whatever I've been talking about as a counseling. So we started the session with understanding the term counseling and how this has been misappropriately used by general public, and everyone would like to call themselves as a counselor, and how this word has been abused. We discussed about it. Then we looked in terms of what is counseling and what is not counseling, and then we understood the differences between counseling and information sharing, the difference between counseling and giving advice. Then we looked at the qualities of a counselor, what should be the qualities of a good counselor. And then we looked at the three stages of counseling, where it starts with the initial phase of setting up goal, then mid phase, and then the final phase. Then we looked at various strategies which can be adopted in the counseling session. And after termination, again, the door should be kept open for the clients, and clients can always come back to a counselor whenever they face problem. But the counseling process itself should be able to empower the client to make them ready to face the problems of day to day. In case when the clients are stuck, the door should be always kept open, and people should be able to come back to counselor and have a discussion and resolve their problems. Thank you all.